Good evening, everyone. I will say that it is honestly a great privilege for me to talk to them on this occasion, because it's not often you get two writers with completely different approaches to text and art and life, and yet with the same intensity, the same kind of passion for both text and image, and who are able to bring it together in very, very unique ways. I am looking forward to understanding more about how they work. I do know that I have worked with Amruta over several books, three books to be precise, in the last 10 years. Each of them has been a progression for her in terms of text and art, and a progression for me as an editor of graphic work. The first was Kari, which was a contemporary tale set in Bombay. It is a book that has now become a classic of graphic narrative in India for sure. And then subsequently she went on to do two works which are about the Mahabharata, retelling the story that we all know in entirely unexpected ways with very, very different art that complements, supplements, lifts the text of her narrative. So we're going to talk to Amruta about both the contemporary and the epic, about her work in terms of text and art. And interestingly, the first time I met her, she'd actually written a whole novel in prose. So clearly that's the other thing you're going to do at some point. So there's plenty to talk about there. Molly, I told her this morning when I met her the first time that if there was a book I have devoured in recent times, it is Drawing Blood. You pick it up, you read that first word, and then you are gone, you're lost. You cannot put it down, you dive into it, and you want to remain in that world which is entirely different, entirely fascinating, and deeply satisfying for all the many insights it has about art, about life, about vulnerability, about all the things that make you want to love life, and even difficulty in your case. So I think this is going to be a great conversation. I'm going to shut up now. Ask Amruta. We're trying to see if we can get their art on loop at the back so you can see. You will presumably be able to tell the difference between whose work it is and which is Amruta's and which is Molly's. Yes. Yeah. So I'm going to ask Amruta to start off by telling us about this compulsion that she seems to have to work with text and image at the same time, to want that cohesion of two very different things to come together before she can tell a story. So where did that begin? How did you first settle on this as your form and reject the prose novel as your primary medium? How did you go about this process?
I don't know how to do things differently, basically. Could we start looping my images, please?
Yes,
and yeah, thank you so much. So basically, it's not a question of strategically planning to marry text and image in any kind of way to seduce people to a certain end result. That's the way I have always thought, and that's the way I've always functioned. So right since I was very little, the visual journals have always been text and image together when I was recording my days and my thoughts. So it was a very natural progression. So the question was only that of permutation combination, of how much and in what ways. And in every possible way, that dilemma continues and it keeps changing in the different books. How much text demands to be there, or how much images are willing to step back for a second to allow the text to do their number.
So tell us about Kari, the starting of that process.
Okay, they're still pulling the images up, I think.
Okay, but those are from Kari. What you saw was the cover, was a cover page, and then...
So, Kari is, I mean, you guys probably have some sense of familiarity with it. It's an urban tale set in Mumbai, and it's about a queer protagonist and friendship and love, and primarily friendship over everything else. And I was still trying to figure out my own relationship with text and image while I was working on Kari. So you have that sense of holding on to the security blanket of vast tracts of word while working with it. Can we loop the images, please, faster? Thank you so much. Or if you'd like me to use the clicker, that would do too. It's an urban world, which is a gray world. It's a world that mirrors Kari's own state. And essentially, the words are like a voiceover over there for the images. And periodically there are flights of fancy, very periodically, in color, and the rest continues in gray and black.
Right.
Thank you so much.
I remember also that when you started putting it together, you worried a little bit about having pages which were all text, pages that were not the conventional column. So tell us about that as well, about how you decided then to go for this really unconventional graphic novel.
See, the boxes have never been terribly appealing. Like, there has always been a desire to not sit inside a rectangle. So while Kari still submitted to that with some rounded edges to the rectangles, Adi Parva minimized it. There were some pages that exploded to the bleeds and some that remained in rectangles. In Sauptik, we have dismissed with the rectangles entirely. So wherever there are different things to be done on a page, it happens organically with elements like a monkey's tail dividing the page into three sections, or like a grotto in which Shiva and Sati are making love, that creating the natural separation for the pages.
It's my favorite page in which Parvati says to Shiva, Bhole Nath, play with me. Yes. And it's just completely absurdly beautiful.
Play.
And there, your pages are coming on now.
Yeah, a bit late in the day.
Shall I move the conversation to Molly? Molly, will you take the same question forward to tell us about why you ended up using art to talk about the memoir, I mean, your life, and how the text and image permutation came together for you?
I've been drawing since I was 4 years old. I started drawing as a way to deal with a world that seemed so difficult and foreign to me. Drawing was my addiction. It was my life preserver. Drawing was always everything to me. I made my first living as an artist, drawing people's pets for and their kids. I always drew. But what I didn't think was I didn't think that I could use words. I only started writing around the time of Occupy Wall Street, which was a protest movement that took off in New York, a protest movement in which my apartment, because of geography, somehow became something of a press room. And I suppose that writing rubbed off on me from all of the journalists that were around me. I think perhaps telling stories is a communicable illness. My first published work of journalism was about my arrest, an arrest that happened during a protest. And the reason that I chose words as opposed to just images was that images, they can hint and they can whisper, and very often they can even scream, but what they can't do, what mine couldn't do, was I felt like they couldn't clearly and explicitly delineate what was going on. Images couldn't analyze. So I wrote about my arrest, and I wrote about arrest in America. And then I drew to accompany that because I couldn't not draw. Drawing was just how I viewed the world. I couldn't imagine not accompanying anything that I had done with drawings.
And at what point did you decide that the memoir needed to be written and that you needed to bring all your ideas together into this one sustained narrative?
God, drawing blood was my memoir. It was the hardest thing I've ever done professionally in my life. I don't think anything compared to that sort of solitary confinement-like torture of being locked in your room and confronted with all of your past selves and having to put them into some sort of consistent narrative arc. Why did I decide to put myself in that terrible situation? I think I was writing a lot of personal essays for Vice, and I wanted to take these things and I wanted to make something more cohesive, and I wanted to use the raw, jagged bits of my life to tell a larger story. So I started writing this beast.
And how did you then persuade your publisher that this is how the book should be published, because it is all color and it's very unusual that any publisher would say, okay, I'm going to publish a novel with color illustrations in it and so on. So as an editor, I'm curious to know how that process went for you.
Actually, I have to thank my amazing editor, Cal Morgan. He's no longer with HarperCollins, but when he was there, he was someone who really championed like the book as an art object. He really saw books as beautiful objects, as the thing that was going to redeem print, as the thing that was going to kill this Kindle-only thing. And so he specifically sought me out because I could draw in color. And he everything that's beautiful about this book, like all of the cool things with the texture, the like matte glossy cover, all of the design, like that's him. He championed that because he is a very unusual man in publishing, because most publishers would look at that and they'd be like, dear God, how are we ever going to make any money off of this? Yes.
But clearly you have. The book has been received wonderfully well. Tell us a little bit about that, about what happened once the book was published, how people then related to it, what they said to you about it.
Drawing Blood was published a year ago. Since then, I've been delighted to get to tour it all around the world. I presented it in India at Jaipur last year. And this is my second time actually touring the book in India, in the south now. I've traveled with it from London and Beirut to tiny towns in Texas to Hollywood and Boston, all over America. And since I've been very lucky to have an incredibly enthusiastic reception for a book that, frankly, it's weird. It's an illustrated art memoir. One of the things that gratifies me the most is that here I am in India and you're all here listening to me. And it would be one thing if this book was just something that people in New York liked. That would mean that it was a small niche thing for a small sliver of the world and a small demographic. But the fact that people around the world, that you guys are interested in it, that's something else, and perhaps that's something that gratifies me the most.
So talking about reception and then going back to expectation, I know that this is something you brought up as well, that when people expect you as writers, as artists, as women, to do certain kinds of things, whether it is the speaking a certain kind of language or speaking about your work in a certain way, producing certain kinds of work, how do you deal with that? How do you do from expectation to the reception? What has been that journey for you?
Well, unlike Molly here, my relationship with art is not an instinctive one, actually. Much as I draw, I'm less self-confident about my images than about my text, which is a little bit hard to sort of reconcile with the way Sauptik especially looks. But to me, just pushing it to the point where I could trust the image has been like a 7 or 8 year long journey for me, you know? So words have always been my primary ally. That's why I keep pushing that writer, artist, you know, up ahead. Expectations, I think the only way to function around that is to not think about that very much. And that's unfortunately easier to do. There's something guileless and beautiful about first work, because no one's waiting for you and nobody expects anything out of you. And in a sense, there's a lot of license to do precisely what you want, because so little rides upon you. So there was beauty to it, but that quality is fast to disappear. You know, I mean, as soon as you hit the second work, either people have loved you for a reason, and there's a part of you, I mean, since all writers have got a hole in their heart in which they're seeking to find people to love them, there is a part of you that wants to not lose the love of people that approved of something that you've done first. But somewhere along, you need to figure out if you want to keep doing the same number, you want to keep writing the same kind of story again, or you want to push it a little bit. And for me, from book one to book three, it has been a process log. It has been pretty much me sorting out my stuff. So if Kari very obviously looks like me on account of the dark brow and the angular face, to me, Ashwatthama is equally close to home because of his roiling or because of his issues, whether it is with rivalry, whether it is with sense of not being good enough.
Sorry, just to interrupt to say, Sauptik is the story of the Mahabharata from the point of view of Ashwatthama, which is the...
Yeah. Possibly the most non-heroic person that you could find to tell a hero's story. And the previous narrator had been Ganga, right? So vis-a-vis the two books, there was really an issue of expectations, because people that reached Adi Parva after having loved Kari or engaged with Kari had a sense of feeling almost abandoned, because they didn't know what had happened. And there is a sense of wanting to presume. There's a lot of presumptions that go with it. So why is a edgy urban chick suddenly going godly on us, basically? You know, so what are all these stories that have, you know, the same old lore? Kitni baar Mahabharat bataoge? You know what I mean? Like, how many times are these people going to keep chewing on the same cud? I don't see it as the same cud at all. To me, it is a deeply personal journey, even with the epics, you know? So it was important for me to hold my ground and do what I felt was necessary for my pushing the envelope. And I know that I've become certainly stronger technically, but also more refined with my use of word and possibly just more, I mean, my person is different than my person was in 2008.
And so if you did a Kari 2 now, it would be a very different Kari?
Oh, Kari 2 would be women with, you know, jowli and gray in the whiskers and lovers, you know, who have somewhat loosened, lost their teeth a little bit, perhaps.
Right. But Molly, I mean, going back to the same point here, you've done some really crazy things in that memoir of yours, whether you did them in real life or whatever, but the book just springs surprises at you. Adventures, madness, all nights of doing things that I would not imagine that somebody could do and get away with almost. She does something, if you haven't read the book, there's one point where she's taken a room, a suite in a hotel, and it's a project where she's covered the walls with white paper from end to end. It was paper. And she's just spending every moment just painting. And it's a live thing. It's being live streamed. There are videographers and people watching. And everyone is like a participatory art project. And what, 10 hours that you just kept painting at a stretch?
I think pretty much all of my waking hours, because I had a week and, what was it, 280 square feet or something to fill.
So please recreate that for me, because that night, those days, and of course it ends with all kinds of, like a mad launch party almost with semi-naked women in bathtubs. I mean, just this entirely glorious way of celebrating art and life that you would ever come across. But it'd be great if they could hear from you what it was like.
I have always rejected boxes. At the start of my career, I was known as someone who drew beautiful dancing girls and decadent nightclubs, someone who drew places where bankers who destroyed our country's economy would blow through $2,000 a night on bottles of champagne while the most beautiful circus performers in the world mocked them on stage. That's my background. But as the world changed, I also started to do other work. I started to do work about politics, about protest, and then later about refugees, about prisons, about war. And the reason that I did both of this work, that I did two work about everything, I mean, the reason that I just drew an 8-foot tall drawing of a cat on a wall in Bangalore a few days ago, is because, my God, life is so short. And this is all we have, and I just want to use my art to consume everything in the world, right? Because we have so few moments, and there's so much. There's so much richness and beauty and horror and kindness and resilience and grandeur. And if you're an artist, how could you not want to just take your pen and capture all of that? I mean, I feel that, you know, marketing people, corporations, they want to put all of us in these little boxes, right? They want us to be serious, frivolous, you know, sexy, intellectual, you know, soft, hard, good, bad, you know, boxes. But that's not how humans are. We are these complex, impure, and multifaceted things, whether we're an artist or whether we're anything else. And I just use my art to express that. Now, as for Week in Hell, Week in Hell, the project where I locked myself in a room and I drew 280 square feet of tiny, tiny little drawings in a week. I did that because I was sick of what I had done before. I was so tired of the art that I had done, and I figured that if I could put myself somewhere where I just had to draw, there was nothing else, where I could draw and draw and draw, that I could sort of empty myself. I wanted to draw so much that there was no more cliché left in me. I wanted to do violence to those clichés. That's what Week in Hell did. And then, yeah, we had a depraved party afterwards.
There's something very intriguing about what you say about your friends and family and so on. For me, it was your mother. I think it'll be pretty much unlike any mother anyone in this country knows, because Molly does not write about her mother really in any great detail. She has all these scenes about things that are happening, her nights she's doing stuff, the art she's doing, the writing, all the brilliant stuff she's doing. And then suddenly she'll drop in a line which says, and my mother used to come and watch me do everything, you know? And I'm thinking, mother? Like, mother is someone you would keep very far away from this stuff. So how, what is this, like, relationship you have with your mother that allows her to be so much a part of your world? Like,
my mother is a brilliant artist. She is a brilliant illustrator. She gave me the gift of showing me that art is a trade, that art is just a job that adults do that you can use to feed your kids. It's not anything fancy and far away. It's a way that you make a living, the way that she put food on the table and fed me with. And she is an incredibly and stunningly talented artist. We also come from a family of artists. My great-grandfather, he was a member of the Bund, which was a Jewish anti-Zionist socialist revolutionary group that flourished in Eastern Europe at the early part of the 20th century. And he even did paintings of his memories of his friends beating up people who broke strikes, or a girl that he liked breaking windows. I mean, and he was an artist and he was a radical, and that's how my family was. They were artists and they were deeply, deeply unconventional people. Of course, I was also a terrible child. My mother will confirm this. I got into a lot of trouble at school, got expelled one time. My mom is a single mom, and I know that I put too much burden on her by causing so much trouble and always having to deal with it. But she is always someone who encouraged me, always someone who taught me how to do art, always someone who taught me to push and to question, and someone I talk to every day.
Right, and your world is peopled by friends of all kinds. I mean, they fill the book, they fill your life. What does friendship mean to you?
Oh God, I was a very solitary child. I was very bad at people. I was very bad at making friends. Whenever there was someone who could stand me, I would just like kind of hold them so close and they would be like, ah, run. So I suppose that when I grew up and when I came into a world where there were other people like me, other people who were bookish and weird and interested in art, I suppose we just tried to build our little utopias together. My friends, and especially my friends who are women, are people who inspire me so much with their diamond hard toughness, with their talent, with their beauty, with their bravery, with their strength. These are people that I drink whiskey till dawn with, and we try to hash out the problems of the world. They're people who I make art with. They're people who inspire me. My last gallery show was giant, like 6 feet tall portraits of my friends. I don't know, right? Maybe in the Trump world, they'll be members of my resistance cell. Who knows?
Trump. We should probably talk about Trump in a bit.
Dear God.
But Amruta, I want to go again, this idea of drawing yourself, because you both draw portraits of others and of yourself, and you have Kari emblazoned there, who everyone will look at and say, oh, this is Amruta. How do you, what is this relationship you have with your body that allows you to put it out there for the world to see? Is that a different body then that you don't have any relationship with once it's on the page? Or is it all right for people to imagine you are that and conflate them?
My own equation of the world is that what else is there, you know? I mean, basically, if it doesn't mirror onto your person or your mind, or what else is there to perceive things with? So, in a sense, it is all out there in the work. And when I look at Kari, as she is right now, it is a sense of looking at possibly a younger sister, perhaps, you know? So the equation goes from being embarrassed at a mirror reflection to having a sort of fond connection with something which is a older version, or like a something once removed in some ways. But that trend totally continues with the other work also.
And you know, there are writers in India who will always say things like, I don't really want to write about sex because, you know, my children might read it, my family might read it, my mother-in-law may read it, etc. Clearly, neither of you has a problem putting yourself and your bleeding hearts out there on the page and letting anybody see or read or reimagine you. What kind of bravery is this? Where does it come from?
I have certain things that I don't write about. I don't write in detail about my partner or my current romantic relationship, probably because I prefer to keep having a partner. I don't know. I suppose it's just... I've had things that terrified me. They terrified me to put them out there. I wrote about my abortion in my book. And America is a climate where if you write about abortion, people will despise you. They will go after you. America is in some ways still a very religiously conservative country in certain parts of it. And I did it because I thought that it was something that I suffered from because I didn't have models and I didn't have people to talk to about it. And so I thought no one else should suffer the same way. And while a lot of people did call me a whore and threatened to kill me because it's Twitter, it was more than made up for by the fact that probably hundreds of women wrote to me, including women who were writing from places where abortion was illegal, or women who had abortions in the US that were illegal before the court decision legalized it. And probably of all of the pieces I've ever done, that was the one that maybe moved things a bit, that changed things a bit, at least in people's lives. And so I thought, okay, perhaps people will, you know, threaten to kill me in various imaginative ways, which they're not going to do. They're just going to bloviate about it. But I can also change things, and so I don't care.
But in terms of Kari, it was interesting. I don't have backlash of people wanting to kill me at all. But I did have a wave of younger people, people that were, you know, queer young things, you know, androgynous people, people that didn't necessarily... By now, pretty much nobody embraces, you know, everybody's non-binary, as far as I can tell right now. But at that point, I think there was a certain currency that was missing, a certain language that was less present than is there in the popular culture. Yeah. And certainly less role models, certainly less representation of certain kinds of ways of being in the public eye. Yeah. So I think what I received from that was a certain relief at their reality being reflected. So there was that. Vis-a-vis other things, by now, I think... I know that art and literature manifest in different ways in people's lives, but for me it is not so satisfying to just cut my veins in public anymore. I'm not interested in that anymore. It doesn't feel like the right thing for me to be doing. Mm. So what does one do in that case when one wants to have a sincere communication but without it being bloodletting in public? So it's one step beyond. It's sublimating rage and angst and things. It's almost... Being a gardener of beauty becomes like an act of revolution almost, the way I see it. You know what I mean? It's not prettification. It's not whitewashing. Mm. So my desire to try and move from a murky gray palette to these iridescent colors that are there in Sauptic, to me that has been, it's a very personal trooping march. It doesn't come naturally to me. That is not my palette. That is not what comes to me naturally when I reach out to a brush. So that for me, you know, and also challenging the notion that there is one way to be an alert person receiving this world. I don't wish, I know the role of warriors. I know the role of the people that will bring a building down, that will bring the tower down. But who are the people who will plant a garden? Who are the paramedics that are going to come and touch somebody softly? Why is it that these people are undervalued? So in Sauptic, for example, there is one small tale about these two Pandavas called Nakul and Sahadev, who do not even exist. They are a blip in people's imagination because they just don't seem to be up to much heroic stuff. You know, they're like non-entities. But to me, it felt like these creatures, one of the few things that is known about them, aside from them being very good looking and good with horses and possibly astronomy, is that they were soothing and beautiful. So the fact that these entities who could bring a calming, sane beauty to a situation that was rife with nothing but bloodshed, to me the undervaluing of these kind of characters tells me something about the way our society is perceiving the role of people or useful people or people that are doing something worthwhile. And in my work, that is something that I really, really, I don't... To me, it is a problem that the only thing that is valued is the voice of warfare, the debunking and the deconstruction, the destruction, the demolition vocabulary. So is there a different way? Is there a Nicola Rorick way of being somebody that takes beauty as a manifesto without being unintelligent or stupid about that.
Well said, absolutely.
What you said about being a gardener of beauty, I mean, my God, one of the features of this global slide to fascism that we're seeing, this slide that in my country is manifested by Trump winning, but is also something that stretches from Putin to Erdogan across the world. One of these features is this glorification of things that are traditionally manly, of war, of brute power, and with it, this belittling of beauty. They want to make beauty seem like something weak. Yes, weak, stupid, impotent. No, no, no. Beauty is resistance. Beauty is dangerous. Beauty is something that they seek to control and to minimize because it is so very, very powerful, and it's beyond their control. They can't create, and that's why they seek to minimize it. When you make beautiful things, and I don't just mean things that are officially art, I mean beauty in everyday life, you're resisting this slide into authoritarianism that's manifesting around the world. So beauty is a way to fight.
Okay, we'll keep the questions quick and crisp. Yes, starting with you, sir.
Thank you so much. On the theme of beauty, creativity and resistance, to you, Amruta, you mentioned that Nakula and Sahadev. But one would like to know in what way they linked beauty to resistance. Now, being beauty is good to be soothing, but beauty as an act of resistance and rebellion.
That is not what I said.
No, no. What I want to know that in what way Nakula and Sahadeva, in their enactment in Mahabharata, they also did acts of creative resistance to the regime of horror that is being perpetrated.
They gave somebody reason to come back home and sleep peacefully.
No. But that is not the only aspect of beauty that we are talking about. My query to you, Molly, would be that again in the same spirit, you know, how do we rethink aesthetics? You know, you are putting us in the direction of aesthetics and resistance. But resistance, again, how does it recover a sense of beauty? In what way, like a resistance which is not aware of beauty is different from a resistance which is aware of beauty?
One of the most intense places that I have covered is Gaza. I visited Gaza. I was lucky enough to visit Gaza in 2015, where I covered a neighborhood called Shujaiya, which was demolished by Israel during the 2014 war. They bombed it, then they came in with tanks, and they shot the buildings, and they bulldozed them. And on the wreckage of these buildings, people painted murals. My collaborator for my next book is a Syrian journalist, and one of the collaborations that we did, he sent me photos from Eastern Aleppo, which has also been decimated by government bombs. And on one of those buildings that had been bombed, someone had painted a giant smiley face, and it said, "Smile for your enemies." And it was flat surface, so you could see it from a plane. That's what I mean by beauty as resistance.
Somebody there? Yeah. Okay. Michael.
My question is to Amruta. Now, Adi Parva was a lot about consonance and dissonance and about balance and about how everything forms a circle in the end. Now, when I read Soptic, you know, could you shed some light on what the core theme was on those lines? Because there were trees, there were herbs, there was beauty. So what exactly was your theme of, you know, when it came to Soptic?
In several things, but most notably, I think it's a push-pull versus, you know, of civilization versus the forest in some ways. That's the forest that you see. It's also far more harrowing than Adi Parva was ever, you know. Sauptik is a bloody book. It's a book about a man who has very little to redeem him. It's a very masculine book in some ways, you know, and a very, you know, roiling, non-heroic kind of a character. So to me, in that sense, it is the counter book to Adi Parva. It is the fire book to the water book that Adi Parva was. And in many ways, it is the death book to the birth book that Adi Parva was. Yeah.
Molly, you mentioned how the written word can analyze in a way that art can't. As a writer, as an artist, does the analytical works, do the analytical works of writers and journalists move you more, or is it the subtlety and the slivers of reality that's represented by artists that you're more inspired by?
I have a different relation to art and to writing. Writing is hard for me. Every single time I see a blank page, I think this is the time I'm not going to be able to fill it. To be able to write well always seems like a bit of a miracle. And so when I see someone using words and using ideas in that way, it's like magic to me. I mean, I'm awed by it. With art, when I draw now, I know what I'm doing. I've done it for 29 years every day. And so when I look at a painter, even the greatest painters, I'm looking at them almost more like, you know how a magician might look at another magic show and they try to deconstruct, where were they hiding their hands when they did that card trick? I think I look perhaps at art more as a craftsman, and I look at writing more with that spirit of like, my God.
Thank you for that wonderful session. My question is, there is resistance art and there is art. And you said as an artist, one should do everything that is possible. But most of the times, the space that art that comes out of resistances get more space sometimes than the resistance itself. So how do you see this dichotomy in art? You know, like, can there be an art where there's no resistance or no history or no sense of storytelling at all? Is it even possible?
Oh, yeah, sure. I mean, look at Fabergé eggs. I think that there's lots of art that's purely decorative, and God bless it. I mean, look at these canopies you're under. My God, they're so beautiful. I would not want to live in a world which wasn't filled with things as beautiful as that. But yes, it is true that art that's associated with a movement often gets more space. And it is true that there's all sorts of art that's, you know, not about resistance at all. But I don't know, the world is big, and art is just a way of, it's just a way of chronicling that world. So there's room for all kinds.
Well, also, and resist is one thing. You know, there are other things that art is trying to do. Sometimes you're trying to embrace, and sometimes you're trying to percolate beautiful things that are fast being lost because there's a carnage going on, and you know, people think everything should be dispensed with. But perhaps that's not the case. So, I mean, resistance is the one important task, but there's other things that art is simultaneously trying to do in different hands.
Like making people feel less alone in the world.
For sure, wanting them to feel like there's hope in anything at all.
Exactly, and what you were saying about preserving things that are about to be lost. I mean, I think perhaps when I say resistance, that has a somewhat narrow connotation. It's like, you know, raised fist against a red background, you know, quite cliche. But I also think that what you were saying, preserving these values of beauty and of hope and of, you know, a thoughtful life, that this is a resistance too in many times.
Hi, this question is to Molly. You'd mentioned that when you wrote about your abortion, it was met with a lot of hate, a lot of resistance, and that was even before Trump was in power. Now that he truly is in every sense of the word, what do you think will happen to the freedom of expression that was there in America, or do you think it will be affected, and what do you think the future of art or anything, the spoken word, would be?
No one can deny that there is a huge upswing of hatred that people are encountering by bigots that are emboldened by Trump. This hatred manifests itself online. It also manifests itself offline in hate crimes that have been increasing. However, my God, there was art under Stalin. I mean, there was art under the most brutal totalitarian regimes in the world. If Americans are so damn weak that someone's saying, like, I'm going to kill you, but with misspellings is enough to make us shut up, then what does that say about us? Dear God.
Molly, this question is to you. Looking at your images, I'm struck by how much they recall photographic representations of reportage, documentation that's so prevalent online and in media today. And there's something in your images. I mean, they're not narrative panels. They're not telling stories in terms of sequencing. But in terms of the single image, that is so often used in reportage and general media today. And I'm seeing a comment there that is missing from those photographs. What do you think about the state of photojournalism today?
Thank you so much. And it's true, the way that a photograph like this one is used and the way that it was made is very similar to how photojournalism is made. I use them to accompany my articles. They're based on photos or sketches that I do on the ground. They're all things that I've seen. They're all places that I've been. I mean, photojournalism, I know so many brilliant photojournalists who, God, are like, I just need to say, like, they're like some of the bravest journalists there, because like a writer can be like way behind the lines, but the photojournalist is literally like sticking his head up, like waving his camera around, you know, while bullets are flying. Photojournalists who cover war are, I mean, are astoundingly brave people. I think we live in a time of the ubiquitous image, and in some ways that's taken away the specialness of photos because everyone has phones and everyone can even like do nice looking images, put enough filters on them, right? But we also live in a time where the photo of Aylan al-Kurdi, the young Syrian boy who drowned trying to reach Europe, that changed the way Europe received refugees. The single image still has power, and photos still have a role as proof that art doesn't have. I think that what I bring to it, as opposed to what a photographer does, is that the hand is clearly visible when you draw in a way that is sometimes elided by photography. Anyone who sees my work, they see, oh, you spent time on that, that's yours, went through your eyes, out your hands.
Hi, thanks for the lovely session. Question to both of you is, in terms of the color, like what kind of color scheme you choose for your artwork, like what is the internal process that's going on? I'm just curious to know, like, the color scheme for your books, your artwork, like what goes on inside?
I've become more and more aware of the ability of colors to create force fields and atmospheres around you. And the fact that it's not incidental, the reason why a Mahayan Buddhist monastery is a certain color, or the reason why certain tapestries are a certain way, you know? So this business of it triggering things, it suggesting things to you, it's putting you in a state, is more and more clear, and with time I'm beginning to understand how to use it better. So the work that I'm currently with, or with which I was, which I've ejected out of my system now, it lends itself beautifully because it has stories nestled within stories, and each of them are a certain emotional universe in their own. So the palette in the book is very much drawing from what that mood was supposed to be there for you, doing to you. So there are the earthy schemes, which are the battlefield schemes. There are the iridescent schemes, which are the, you know, Devlok kind of schemes. So it changes based on what the story needs you to be feeling like.
I also obviously use my colors to create a certain type of mood, but sometimes I just get obsessed with color palettes. I was in a court, and there was this old legal document from hundreds of years ago, and the paper, I guess, was green with mold. And the ink had kind of faded, and I was like, my God, that absinthe green and that gray ink, it's so beautiful. And I spent so long trying to like dye paper with green tea and just to make it moldy, like just to do anything. I probably gave myself some sort of spore disease in the lungs trying this. But I wanted that. I wanted that thing that I saw. And I get inspiration for different color palettes all sorts of different ways, but I tend perhaps most to be inspired by rot and randomness, stuff like that.
I just have that one last thing to say before we wrap up, which is, you've been talking about the joy and the beauty and all the good things of art. What do you do when confronted by ugliness? What is your reaction to non-beauty or, the bad?
Karthika, everything that I'm doing is a reaction to non-beauty. I mean, if you think that this is coming out of everything feeling joyous on a day-to-day basis, that is absolutely not what it is. And if it is almost militantly becoming colored in a certain fashion or militantly becoming calmer, it is a militant act of choosing that sort of a way.
So it is, you know, a reaction to what you're
saying. It is absolutely a reaction. And it is absolutely a plea almost that one listens to the other rather than everybody, I find my voice, and who's found their ears? You know?
Good question. So Molly, is that, how do you react?
Umberto Eco once said that something ugly that is rendered well becomes beautiful. Art has that power of alchemy, I think.
Okay, I'm not going to say a word more after that. That was brilliant. Thank you so much, all of you. And thank you, Molly, Amruta. It's been a great session. The word that they used all the time, resistance.
please do not resist reading their books. Go get them, sign them, read them, whatever, but go get them.
Thank you, Karthika. And thank you all for being here.
Thank you.